Okay, good morning. I guess it's morning still. I was asked to talk about microbial sampling and more specifically the questions indicated on this slide. So basically very basics on air sampling. What are the sampling principles? What is the efficiency of different types of samplers? What are options, advantages and disadvantages of each? How do the different sampling approaches answer different objectives? So I'm going to try to cover something that would typically take 3 hours and try to cover in 15 minutes. And it's going to be very basic 101 on sampling. So let's first kind of a review. We heard about different types of samples in the past talks, and this is kind of summarizing on why we might do microbial sampling. One is to verify and quantify the presence of microbial contamination. So there could be suspicion, let's say health outcomes or health complaints, and then you need to verify that is it really related to microorganisms, maybe there's something else going on in the building. Another one is to identify sources. You already established that there is a microbial contamination, but then you have to find the sources so then you can do take control measures.
So then also the control measures. Once you have done something to remediate the microbial problem, you may need to or want to assess, was it efficient? So if you removed the sources or you improved ventilation, did it really help? And then lastly, assess human exposure. I would say that this is mostly used, as Mia mentioned in the morning, there is not yet really a cookbook where you can just take a sample and say that this is now harmful for the health. So mostly at the moment, this is still in research studies used assessing human exposure. And this is actually what I'm doing most of my studies are relating to exposure assessment. So my talk might be a little bit biased towards that, but I'll try to cover also these other aspects. So as we've already heard, sampling is only part of the building survey. So there are qualitative assessment looking at water damage, visible mold, moldy odor. So what are the quantitative measures to do the sampling? We have four basic types: air samples, dust samples, surface samples, and building material samples. I guess I can use this one. So let's talk first about air sampling. The basic principles for air sampling for bioaerosols or microbes are exactly the same as any other particles. So we have impaction, inertial impaction, centrifugal impaction, impingement, and then we have filtration. Now, how do you decide if you kind of start to from that basic, like which method to take? You have to keep in mind that when you are selecting a sampler, it may restrict what analysis you are doing. And on the other, if you come from other end, if you have decided on the analysis, you might be restricted on what type of sampler you can use. And I would say that if you have a liquid sample, if you have collected into liquid, that's, I would say, most versatile. You can divide the liquid into many different parts. You can put it under microscope, do microscopic analysis. You can do immunoassay, chemical assays, PCR, next generation sequencing, or cultivation. You can cultivate part of that on agar plate. Also, if you have used another type of sample that you have extracted into liquid, like filter sample, that also offers you then options to do a different analysis. But then you have to deal with, are you getting everything out from the filter into your liquid? So that goes to the extraction efficiency. I also have dotted line here for cultivation because it's known that filter sampling desiccates very sensitive microorganisms. So gram-negative bacteria, for example, filter sampling is not a very good way of if you want to do cultivation analysis. There's also some indication that it might affect if you collect on filter and want to do filtering using filtration principle, that it might affect the bacterial DNA. So there was comparisons looking at filter sampling and impingement sampling, and better results were received from impingement sampling when looking at molecular biological methods for bacteria. So then if you go to any catalog of manufacturer's catalog, you can find a lot of different samplers. So here on the left-hand side, we have impaction onto class light, we have impaction onto agar in the middle, and then filter samples on the upper corner, and then impingement samples lower here. So how do you decide which sampler to take? Because there is a lot of different options available. One important consideration is, a couple of considerations. So first of all, you have to think about the aerosol physics. You want to collect everything that you are interested in. So all those particles that you are interested, that they are collected as efficiently as possible. But also that you maintain the properties of the particles, and especially those properties that you are using for analysis. And classical example is the cultivation analysis. If you are doing cultivation, you want to make sure that your sampler or sampling does not kill the microorganisms. So collection efficiency is one important consideration for the physical collection. And impactors have this typical S-shaped collection curve where we have a 50% efficiency, and that's what is given to the samplers. If you have anything from the collection efficiency for the manufacturers, it says what particle size is collected at 50% efficiency. And for example, for this AGI-30, it is 0.3 micrometer particle. So you want to make sure that the particles that you are collecting or you are interested in are in the area that the sampler has more than 50% collection efficiency. So a couple of examples here. I took two kind of extremes. Thermoactinomycete vulgaris, that is 0.6 micrometers, and then Stachypetrus carthaurum, that is more than four micrometers in aerodynamic size. So for the thermoactinomycete vulgaris, we could use these two samplers here on the left, AGI-30 and Andersen 6-stage. Versus for the Stachypetrus, in principle, we could use all of these samplers because their cut sizes are smaller than the size of the spore. So from collection efficiency point of view, all of these samplers would be okay for Stachypetrus. But there are other considerations that I don't have time to go into it, which is inlet efficiency, potential losses, which are bigger for bigger particles, and also particle bounce. And this is something to keep in mind with spores, that they are very bouncy particles. And they can, even though you think that you are collecting them, they might be bouncing off from the collection surface. Filtration is a little bit different because filtration uses different aerosol physical principles. There's impaction, so we have this S-shaped curve where we are collecting the larger particles, but then we also have diffusion that collects the smaller particles. So we typically have this U-shaped collection efficiency curve for filters. So for filters, efficiency is expressed as maximum penetration is, let's say, 80% at 0.3 micrometer particle, or minimum efficiency at certain particle size. Here are some examples of some commonly used filters for bioaerosol sampling. Upper curves are 0.3 micrometer Teflon and 3 micrometer Teflon, and then we had 1 micrometer polycarbonate, 3 micrometer polycarbonate. On the y-axis you have the efficiency, and on x-axis the particle size. So what we can see here, that the Teflon filters were very efficient. So basically you can collect with both of those very efficiently, even the small particles. Polycarbonate filters, they reach about close to 100% in 1 micrometer and up. So if you are interested in intact bacteria or fungi, fungal spores, you are doing okay with all of these methods. But if you are interested in the fragments that was mentioned earlier, then you might want to look at what filter might be more efficiently collecting the smaller particles. So then we have the floor dust samples, bed dust samples, settled dust samples, and on the bottom here you can see settled dust is actually collecting particles that are settling from the air. Either there are a couple of methods that have been used: electrostatic cloth, and then a pizza box, which is basically just a simple cardboard box that is put in the house for a certain amount of time so you can collect particles that are settling from the air. And I'll try to go quickly the pros and cons of each of these methods. So dust, why people are using dust is very especially used in epidemiological studies because it's considered to be an integrated sample. We heard about the fluctuation in air samples. So with dust sampling, we can kind of look at what's going on in a long term in a house. It's very easy to collect. You can get a lot of dust and you can divide that for multiple analyses. But the disadvantages is that not all dust has been airborne. And also there could be growth. If there's moisture in the surface, there could be microbial growth in the dust. So air sampling, if you want to find out the temporal fluctuations, and this might be, for example, for occupational environments, important to know when are the workers exposed the highest, then air sampling is a good alternative. And it also better represents what we are inhaling, so inhalation exposure, especially if we are using personal samplers that are in the breathing zone. So that is really like, what are we breathing? It's collecting that. But often these samples are quite small and we cannot do multiple analyses, so that's the disadvantage. Settled dust, this is the dust that is collected long-term, letting settle from the air. It is cheap, it can be sampled by the occupant, so you can basically mail them this collection device and ask them to mail it back to you. And this dust has been airborne. Versus the floor dust that we don't know if it was tracked in from foot traffic or was growing on the surface. So this has been airborne and it's a long-term sampling if you want to take a long-term average. Disadvantages is that it's uncontrollable. You really don't have control on what are the air currents there in the building, electrostatic forces and so on. It underestimates smaller particles because larger particles deposit more efficiently. Also, you cannot see the fluctuations, you cannot look at the exposure peaks. And then what is the concentration unit? I mean, you are collecting from the air, but you don't know the volume, so at least you cannot get the concentration in cubic meters of air. I'm going to skip this one, as we heard about the surface and material sampling in the previous talk. And do I have time to show a couple of examples? So these are, I'm showing a couple of examples of now we're talking about this next generation sequencing. This is a very fresh results from our group where we used Illumina MySeq to look at long-term 5-day air samples, bed dust and floor dust. And this is basically showing how the microbial composition or diversity is very different in these three media. Bed and floor are more close to each other, but air is very different. So basically representing a different microbiome. And this has been already shown with cultivation methods. So this is basically also confirming what's been shown with cultivation methods. And I also have a figure from a study from Texas, and Jeff Siegel is a co-author here. It's basically, they looked at settled dust, so collected dust from different surfaces, used an ventilation filter collecting particles, and then used four different active air samplers to collect particles and did the pyrosequencing analysis. And as you can see, there's very little overlap with these three different methods. So the method is kind of depending what method you are using, you're getting different results. So basically the take home message would be that if you want to compare your results with somebody else's results, you need to use the same sampling method, and your analysis is as good as your sample. So basically a lot of the quality of your result will depend on how well you did the sampling. And I did have this slide where I tried to kind of put the purpose and method together, but I think that we can discuss this maybe on the workshop. So basically summarizing, like, what could you choose if you do identify sources or you do assess human exposure. So thank you.